Hello, everybody, and thank you for joining us. I'm Elvis, co-founder and CTO of EdgeDB, and today I'd like to talk about EdgeQL, which is, of course, the query language of EdgeDB. I'll try to explain why EdgeQL is necessary and why it's a better query language for the future. Of course, this is a lightning talk, so I'm mostly going to be showing things, but before we begin, let's talk a little bit about the current state of things. So about 30 years ago, the world has decided that the majority of programs would be modeled and written some object-oriented programming language, but also that those same programs would store most of their state in some SQL database. Unfortunately, we immediately realized that this is far from ideal and problematic enough that we came up with a name for the issue, object-relational impedance mismatch. And of course, impedance comes from the electrical engineering field, where mismatching impedances cause an electrical circuit to be a lot less efficient. So this is the same for software systems. Coupling relational databases and object-oriented programs is not efficient. And a lot has been written about this, a lot of solutions proposed, but unfortunately, it seems like our database tools, or at least our database APIs and frontends, are barely more expressive more efficient than they've been in 2005. So it almost seems like object-relational mismatch is an inevitable fact of life, and we should just accept it. Except, of course, it isn't, and we shouldn't. Object-relational mismatch isn't some law of nature. It exists primarily because we let it. And of course, the reason is that the SQL database world is fairly slow and is either unable or unwilling to fundamentally improve things. On the other side, the application development world has been stuck in the losing war of perpetually writing and rewriting countless object-relational mappers or ORMs. And there are really dozens of public ORM libraries for every programming language and likely thousands of in-house ones. I know this because during the course of my career, I wrote 4 production ORMs. So imagine the collective level of effort expended to write and maintain those ORMs and then inevitably fight them, because sooner or later, the facade of abstraction just falls apart due to how shaky and inconvenient the SQL foundation is. And of course, I also have to mention NoSQL, which is an attempt to deal with the whole problem by removing the relational part altogether. But the reality is that the relational model, the strict schema, and high-level abstract query language are actually very, very useful. And so NoSQL will likely always remain to be no more than a niche. So what do we do? Of course, the answer is simple. We kill the table. Basically, what that means is that we need to adjust the database model and replace SQL with something better. And before we discuss how, let me show you a simple example. So as you might have noticed, we're quite fond of movies at EdgeDB. Lots of our examples are based around some movie-themed schema. Let's continue this tradition and perform a simple task. Select the titles of all movies in our database. So HQL is on the left and the equivalent SQL is on the right. So far, so good. The results are quite similar, short and sweet. Now let's expand things a little bit. Fetch a list of actors for every movie. It's pretty easy to do in HQL. We simply add another entry to our output shape, which is quite self-explanatory and looks a lot like GraphQL. SQL, on the other hand, is suddenly a lot more verbose because we now have to tediously specify the relationship joins, and we had to type a lot more. But the worst part is that our solution is only approximate, because SQL returns a flat list of tuples instead of a nested structure. But HQL does give you actual grouped result. And we'll talk about this later. Let's move on. Simply selecting existing data, of course, is boring. So let's compute something. In this case, an average review score for every movie we selected. In HQL, we simply call the mean function on the set of all associated review scores, like so. And SQL doesn't do too bad either. It's more verbose. It needs an explicit subquery for aggregation, but it's okay. Now, we rarely need to select everything, so let's add an interesting filter condition. Let's say get all movies where Zendaya played a role. In SQL, it's again a simple operation on an associated set. And in SQL, we've got a similar construct, except again, we need a subquery, we need the verbose joins. And by this point, you see a clear pattern that you have to repeat the joins over primary keys over and over again, making everything unnecessarily verbose and hard to read, even for simple cases. Well, let's add a final touch. Movie casts are long, so let's say we only want to fetch the first top five actors. The first five actors in the credits order, because we don't want all the extras and whatnot. So in HQL, it's very easy. Again, we add an order by operator and a limit. And in SQL, unfortunately, we had to rethink the whole query. We cannot just slap a filter and a limit on the entire query, because we want to slice the associated actor set for every movie. So we had to resort to adding a lateral join. And lateral joins actually is something that is fairly new to SQL databases. They didn't exist around about 2015. And some popular databases like MariaDB still don't support them. And the public is generally not very aware of their existence. And it's fairly advanced stuff. So anyway, here's the finished query. HQL, as you can see, can still fit in a single tweet, but you'll need a medium post for the SQL query by this point. And seriously, this shows how quickly SQL becomes a very unwieldy and an ergonomic mess. And this matters very much, of course, because your ability to quickly and effectively express things is the cornerstone of your productivity as a developer. So now let's take a quick step back and take a look at ORMs to compare, because theoretically ORMs should solve some of those problems of SQL and improve the expressiveness and let us do more things with less. So this is our query implemented with Prisma, which is the current state of the art of ORMs, at least within the JavaScript community. And at a glance, this query looks all right. The nested structures of related data is expressed nicely. The filters are there. However, unfortunately, we see that an important bit is missing, and it's the average review score. And this is because Prisma, like most ORMs, lacks a way to actually compute arbitrary expressions in your queries. And so in this case, we have to perform a separate query and then manually join the results, which almost doubles the amount of code. Not only that, under the hood, Prisma actually does three queries to fetch the list of movies and hides it from you. And that's because it simply cannot get away from that inability to express nested sets in SQL generally and efficiently. And remember, this is pretty much the state of the art as far as ORMs go. And if you try any other ORM, the results would be fairly similar or worse. And the bottom line is that it's really hard, almost impossible, to build an efficient object abstraction over generic SQL that supports multiple database implementations of multiple versions. So let's see what would happen if a similar native query language builder targeted SQL instead. So this is our familiar movie fetching query on the left again, and here it is on the right, expressed using our JavaScript query builder library. Remarkably, the JavaScript formulation not only follows the SQL query structure line by line, it's also not much longer. And the best part of it is that this is still a single query, guaranteed. This is a single round trip to the server. And again, let's look at it side by side with an earlier Prisma example. So you can see, you know, how big the difference is. And this is simply because we're not, the query builder in TypeScript targets HQL and not SQL. So now that you've seen it in action, let's talk about what makes HQL so unreasonably effective. And the answer to that is we took the classic relational model and extended it just enough to realize these three core concepts. Object identity, and it's the requirement that every piece of data must have a unique immutable key that is independent from the data itself. So it's things like auto increment AD fields that you have to specify everywhere explicitly in the relational model. You don't need to do that anymore. That's just there. It's an inherent property. Second, links, which builds upon object identity, but it's a formal acknowledgement that data is referencing each other in your model. So you don't have to do foreign keys. You don't have to do explicit joins over primary keys verbosely like you do everywhere else. And last but not least, we made it so that everything can be a set. And this is really important. Object properties, query results, and those sets can nest. So you have nested collections of data. And like the previous example has shown, the associated movie actor list is not, it's really trivial and easy thing to do, unlike SQL. All right, so let's quickly take a look at another example. In HQL, everything is an expression and everything is a set. So this means that you can replace any value with an equivalent expression and vice versa, which means that you can write queries like you write code progressively. So let's take a look. We have a new variable movie title, assign it to Avengers. Now we have another variable actor names, which is a set of names. And now we have a set of actors, which are actual objects that we select from the database using the set of movie actor names. And finally, we insert a new movie object using the variables we computed before. Of course, this is a fairly trivial example. Let's look at another one. Again, we have a set of movie actor names. We select those actors, and now we insert the movie. But note that insert statement itself is also an expression, so you can just write it and assign it to another variable. Let's insert another movie. So now we've done two insert statements within a single query. Now let's say we wanted to update our watch list on some Netflix kind of application. So we select a user account using their login query argument. And then we update that account by adding the newly inserted movies into the watch list of that account. So, and this shows how HQL is actually really, really close to a normal, straightforward programming language. So you don't need to think, oh, what's the declarative syntax for this very simple operation? It just flows normally, like you expect it to. All right, so let's recap. Big ideas of HQL. Graph-relational data model, which solves practically every issue in the object-relational mismatch, right? It lets you traverse, mutate, extract arbitrary graphs of data, semantic graphs of data. Fully defined modern type system. And what this means that unlike SQL, that the SQL standard actually amazingly doesn't include a type system definition. It's not defined, it's implementation specific, which is why every SQL database has its own set of data types and behaviors. In EdgeDB, we actually have specified that data model, and there is a rich library of standard data types, including things like arrays, tuples, collections, all types that you expect to be there in the modern query language, in the modern programming language. HQL is a straightforward compilation target for language bindings. Like I've shown you before, a sneak peek of the JavaScript query builder, and you'll see a lot of it in subsequent talks, really exciting. It simply because it's so composable, and the organization of HQL lets you use it as a compilation target really easily, unlike SQL again. SQL is really, really hard to compile to. And EdgeQL, and this is very important, it's intended to be a complete SQL replacement. And what it means is that whatever you can do with SQL, you should be able to do with EdgeQL, only in a shorter form. And if you can't do something with HQL that you can with SQL, it's a bug. Go and pester us on GitHub and we'll fix it. And lastly, what all of this means is that object-relational mismatch is essentially gone, right? It's we tweaked the model from the bottom. We're not trying to solve it from the top like all the other solutions are trying to do and have been trying to do for decades. And this essentially removes the entire need to write complicated client-side libraries altogether. And so the biggest takeaway here is that we can and should do better than SQL. And EdgeDB is here, EdgeQL is here, and that time is now. Thank you very much.